In this video, we're going to be talking about an upcoming heat wave in the Northwest, multiple days of severe weather in the plains, and a very interesting weather pattern that will have widespread implications and carry us through the middle of May. So let's get started over here in the west part of the states and western Canada, where it's about to warm up in a really significant way. We're talking about potentially record-breaking temperatures this weekend for parts of the Pacific Northwest here. This is all thanks to an unusually strong upper-level area of high pressure, or a ridge, that will lead to an all-out heat wave. And this heat is going to be around for a while. These dark red temperatures to dark browns here showing up in the Pacific Northwest, Western Canada, are 15 to 20 degrees above average, and they persist for days. So heads up over here in Portland, Oregon, where temperatures are going to start breaking 80 degrees Fahrenheit here on Friday. And the mercury is going to climb even higher here in Portland on Saturday as Portland approaches the 90 degree Fahrenheit point. This is going to challenge a daily record here for May 13th that stood for exactly 50 years. You heard me right. We have the potential to break a record, a heat record, set in 1973 this weekend. And of course, it's not just Portland. Cities through the Pacific Northwest and also the Central California Valley in particular, like Sacramento, Spokane, Seattle, even places in British Columbia like Vancouver, through the valleys in Kamloops, and also up into Alberta for Calgary and Edmonton. Y'all will be feeling the heat this weekend and into next week as that high pressure ridge stays in place and roasts. This map shows areas that are seeing record temperatures about a mile above the surface here in pinks and those dark reds. That hot air a mile above the surface is definitely going to be able to mix down to the surface, and many of us will be feeling the impacts here where those red areas are. Thankfully, the Climate Prediction Center and local weather forecast offices are not deeming this heat wave as an excessive heat, which is to say it's not going to be overly dangerous to your daily life. It's just going to be very far above average. Temperatures in the 80s to about 90 degrees Fahrenheit, or about 26 Celsius to 32 Celsius for our international friends, are not insignificant though, especially if you don't have central AC in your residence in the Pacific Northwest and parts of Western Canada. So if that's you this weekend, light prep work is going to go a long way for you to be able to stay cool and stay hydrated. Now, if you're looking to escape this potentially record-smashing heat wave and head to higher elevations to cool off, what you should realize is that this may be a significant accentuator for the ongoing melt of our huge snowpack in the Sierra Mountains. Most creeks and rivers will be running higher, faster, and much colder. And unfortunately, with the heat wave comes the talk of fires. Today, we have a large area of critical concern for fire weather conditions here, particularly in New Mexico, and this will linger just a little bit for the next few days, but it will go away. More on that in a bit. Alberta, in particular, has been battling close to 100 wildfires this week of various sizes. With this heat wave coming up, conditions could worsen and escalate quickly for ongoing active areas. Some of the smoke from the Alberta wildfires has already made its way to Newfoundland, thousands of miles away. You can see the smoke from Alberta traveling right along this area right here, all the way to Newfoundland. This is being transported by the jet stream, about 6 miles above the surface. We should definitely be thinking of our friends in Alberta as they go through this stretch of fire weather conditions, especially those who have already evacuated in several towns in those active wildfire areas. So, the Southwest. The fire conditions are going to let up after the next couple of days. Why is that? Here's a look at the day 6 through 10 precipitation outlook from the Climate Prediction Center, particularly for May 15th through 19th. Notice how we're turning much more wet than average down here, particularly in Arizona. This is the driest time of year for the desert Southwest in Phoenix and Tucson, Arizona. Only 4 times on record has Phoenix recorded more than an inch of rainfall total across the entire month of May in history. So is this the monsoon early? No. Through the weekend, a sneaky circulation south of the ridge will pop up. Winds from the east aloft will be strong enough to bring in moisture sitting in place from the South Plains and the Texas vicinity. In particular, the small area of moisture that's being transported into the desert Southwest will lead to mountain thunderstorms. So unfortunately, Phoenix and Tucson might not get much rain unless a lucky storm here or there over that next week moves into the valleys off of the mountains. So this is not the monsoon. A monsoon is particularly a more permanent shift in wind direction. The thunderstorms that come from the monsoon are not actually the monsoon itself, but a monsoon lasts for a couple of months, not this week-long period of thunderstorm activity in Arizona that's coming up. This is a different springtime pattern that doesn't come around too often. So even though we don't have the monsoon in place in the desert southwest anytime soon, we are going to see some really flooding rains for another area, particularly here in South Texas. An extended period of rain and thunderstorms is expected across much of Texas starting late this week, into the weekend, and into early next week. And this could have the potential for widespread flooding. So here's the flash flooding risk for today, with a moderate risk in eastern Texas, including parts of Houston. Tomorrow, a little lighter day on precipitation for much of Texas, but active in the high plains. Friday, where we really start to see those heavy rains begin right about Laredo and north. And Saturday, where that same area really persists. All of these outlooks being from the Weather Prediction Center. The heaviest rainfall, up to 8 to 12 inches, is expected near San Antonio into the Hill Country, with some isolated places potentially seeing more than 15 inches of rain through Sunday, especially down here in South Texas. We could see up to 6 to 8 inches for places in West Texas as well throughout this period. This will be beneficial for a lot of this area that's actually sitting in some elevated to extreme drought. But again, it's going to be a lot of rain in a relatively short period, so please don't drive through flooded roads. Now for severe weather forecasting. The plains look to be the hot spot for severe weather over the next few days, as a slow-moving storm travels across the Front Range of the Rockies and into the High Plains. So today, Wednesday, May 10th, there's a slight risk in yellow, or 2 out of 5 for all hazards, including tornadoes, large hail, and damaging winds across much of the High Plains here. This does include y'all in Denver, Colorado Springs, Pueblo, and even up here into Cheyenne and Rapid City. All of y'all are going to see at least wind and hail risks that were listed there. The risk for tornadoes in particular is concentrated here in the brown, right through the Denver area in the afternoon hours and to the northeast of the metro as storms move that direction along I-76 through the evening. Now let's look at the moisture in place here at about 6 p.m. Mountain Time tonight. There's our dry line, except it's horizontal. This model, the HRRR, resolves a boundary, a dry line, draped west to east, and that will act as a boundary to initiate one massive supercell seen here on this run in particular. There's a good chance they'll form and intensify pretty rapidly over Denver compared to what's shown here, as this model sometimes fails to initiate storms on time and rapidly develop them. So here's an atmospheric sounding that shows a pretty nasty environment right ahead of that supercell at 6 p.m. Mountain Time from that run of the model. Plenty of instability seen here as we look at our temperatures going up with height following this red line. And on the photograph here in the top right, we have plenty of nadir juice in particular, winds about a mile above the surface. And these will lead to the possibility of a dangerous tornado, which is the hazard type indicated on this sounding. The astute eye may see that this environment is actually interacting with the storm nearby, but only at a particular layer right in here. The rest of the data shows conditions favorable for a gnarly storm if one were to track right through the atmosphere where these conditions are in place. So it's been a little while for y'all in the High Plains and the Denver Metro. You got some hailstorms last night, so let's stay weather aware through the rest of today. Even while I was making this video, actually, this Storm Prediction Center outlook just updated, and now we have a 10% risk for tornadoes right in these same areas I was just talking about. So please, let's stay weather aware. Tomorrow, Thursday the 11th, the risk transitions slowly to the east. A huge slight risk is in place from the Storm Prediction Center, and this very well may lead to concentrated areas inside this broad risk being upgraded to higher levels, maybe down here in Oklahoma, maybe across parts of Kansas. However, as it stands, there are two modes here. Wind and hailstorms are going to make up the northern half of this risk in particular, while the southern half has a few key differences that I'm going to highlight. The most important thing is that winds will be supportive of tornadoes in Kansas and Oklahoma in particular in the brown areas here. And in western Oklahoma, we can see the dry line pushing forward right in here. This would be a focused area for strong storms to develop, push through a weak cap that exists in the atmosphere in the late afternoon. On Friday, the severe risks are focused in Omaha and much of Iowa once again as the storm breathes its last breath and finally dissipates after this day. Once again, the primary risks for these areas up here in the Midwest and also eastern Nebraska will be in the late afternoon hours, though there may be a round of morning time storms that should be less severe in nature. There's also a slight risk down here in South Texas around Laredo and San Antonio, and that's associated with all that moisture in place we talked about earlier that's going to lead to the flash flooding risks down there. After that, disorganized severe threats will probably arise along the east coast into next week. This is because the upper air pattern moves this trough or lower pressure down from northeast Canada and into the eastern coast, which could lead to a couple things. We could see a backdoor cold front come through parts of the northeast, or we could also see a possible shortwave swing off part of this trough here and bring some severe weather downstream of it. So keep your eyes peeled for any severe weather risks that crop up in the middle of the week up here if it does come to fruition. As we look into the future, an interesting pattern is setting up as our death ridge, you may or may not have heard about, continues to build up next week. But why Death Ridge? The name is actually a colloquial one that talks about the death of the dreams of a storm chaser trying to find some tornadoes. That storm chaser is not going to be able to see any traditional tornado outbreak setups at this time of year if we have something called the Death Ridge. So it's actually a good thing. But unfortunately, the term is popular and has existed for decades. I'm sure they've said it at some point during the popular series Storm Chasers. So at some point, it will find its way to you out of context. I'm here to squash that problem. So here's how that Death Ridge formed this time. In particular, we're looking about 4 miles above the surface here and watching this pattern roll through. There's our severe weather maker over the next few days showing up right there in the high plains. And here's this big old trough over the North Pacific south of Alaska. As our severe weather maker stalls in the same place generally, the air right in between gets pinched up, and you can see it blow up there in the oranges and reds. So while that air mass gets pinched up, it gets squeezed off to the north here. And as it gets squeezed, it amplifies in nature. So that amplification of that part of the wave or the ridge that's forming, that's what causes those hot temperatures at the surface. And at the same time, this being in place prevents all those low pressure systems from forming over the Great Plains here. Those are what typically cause tornado outbreaks. So if those aren't there, we're not going to see a localized area for a tornado outbreak. So that's it. That's the Death Ridge for you. Not too deadly at all. Heck, it even prevents some more dangerous storms from forming. But unfortunately, while it prevents tornadoes, it does lead to something else. Derechos. So very quickly, a derecho is a long-lasting, very powerful windstorm that carries continuous, significant wind gusts all along its path for at least about 250 miles. So this graphic shows the typical setup and places for certain types of derechos to occur. Now note that we don't have this trough over in the west here. This is where our death ridge is. But what's similar is this area right here of airflow that corresponds to progressive derechos. Progressive derechos are windstorms like the one that blew through central Iowa and northern Illinois in August 2020, or perhaps the infamous one that went through parts of the Midwest all the way to the Atlantic coast in June 2012. So again, this part of the image is in particular what we're going to have in place. This airflow specifically from the northwest that could lead to some progressive derechos. But the good news is that derechos need super humid and unstable air, and it's not really quite corn season up here in the Midwest yet. I think that'll lower the chance of a damaging wind event like a progressive derecho quite a bit for now. So the hope is that we actually, overall, do have a lull of severe weather in the month of May. That would be quite something, wouldn't it? So, while we're able to focus away from severe weather, maybe for just a little bit, please consider checking out our new channel, The Y'all Squad. We've got a brand new video showcasing our relief efforts in Coal and Shawnee, Oklahoma. I covered those tornadoes live. So to see the results of our mission after watching the tornadoes happen live, compacted in a video format like that, and knowing how we help people, it's incredible. From a live look at a tornado to making a difference in person on the ground. The link to that video is in the description. So thank you for watching this video, and I'll see you in the next one.